It's a pleasure to be here at this event celebrating Marcel Bachier. I had several very nice interactions with Bachier, in particular early in my career. I remember very fondly one at dinner I had long time ago at his place that was extremely memorable with him and his, it was just him, his wife, and myself and Sergio Kleinerman. And it was extremely nice, and he was always very kind. So it's very nice to be here. So I want to talk about some results about optimal regularity for geometric flows. And so this will be joint work with Bill Minicotti. And so when one model various physical phenomena, then one often tracking fronts that are moving with curvature-dependent speed. When the speed is actually the curvature, this leads to one of the classical degenerate nonlinear partial differential equation. And so one wonder, what is the regularity of solutions to this equation? And so what I want to talk about here is the answer to this. So I want to talk about, so we can actually, for this equation, we can actually prove the optimal result. So we can prove exactly what is, how regular are solutions. But then after that, you can still ask. So initially, we were wondering, you know, could solutions be more regular? Could they even behave? So at this point, as I'll tell you about in a minute, we know that solutions are always twice differentiable. The second derivative is always bounded. You can completely characterize when the second derivative is C2. In general, it's twice differentiable, but there are examples where it's not C2. When it's C2, it's in general not C3, okay? So we can completely characterize this. But even so, undetermined by this, we still wonder, even if they have this low regularity, is it still possible that solutions could behave as if they were much more regular? And I'll try to tell you why we are interested in that. And so so the question is sort of the most optimistic. So solutions are just twice differentiable, but we still want to know, is it possible that the solution could behave as if they were even analytic, okay? And I'll show, I hope to convince you of a case where we can actually show this. And again, I'll try to talk about some motivation. Why do we care about this? And there are some real reason for that. Then I want to talk about, after we talk about that, so after we talk about this particular degenerate equation and how to prove optimal regularity, again, the optimal regularity is, in order to prove optimal regularity, the key is actually to understand the underlying geometry. If you were just tackling this problem as it has been before, but if you were just tackling it purely analytical, then you wouldn't be able to prove the optimal regularity. You would only, as a classical result, you would only be able to prove that solutions are Lipschitz. So, but using our understanding of the underlying geometry, we're able to prove this optimal regularity results. But now after talking about this equation, I want to see do these techniques apply to other equations? And I'll sort of describe some results at the end towards this. So here's the basic idea, right? So this is a kind of classical thing that you have a front. In this case, it's the perimeter of a fire. The fire is evolving over the time. You're trying to track the perimeter as it evolves. And you see in this simple example where the fire initially have two different branches. Over time, those branches merge. And so you get this kind of a little bit more complicated behavior. And so here's another sort of classical example of where you're tracking a moving front. This is oil droplet on water. And so in this case, the droplets can come together and a droplet can break into two. So you have this sort of behavior. You're trying to track it. And so this leads to, I'll talk a little bit more about it, but it leads to, eventually it leads to this. This is like the poster boy or the poster child for this kind of equation. So this is this nonlinear degenerate elliptic equation. It's degenerate because it's forcing you, it's asking you to divide by the norm of the gradient of the function. And it's easy to see that the function always have critical point. There's always point where the gradient vanishes. So it's asking you somewhere to divide by zero. Okay, so that's why the equation is degenerate. So this is the elliptic version of the equation, and there's a corresponding degenerate parabolic version. Right, but you see, on the other hand, it's a relatively simple equation, right? This is obviously an equation, it's a nonlinear equation, but it's an equation that is modeled by the Laplace equation, right? But it's nonlinear and it's degenerate, right? and so here's the optimal regularity result, that solutions to this equations, to this elliptic equation, is always twice differentiable everywhere. At critical points, so this is where the equation is. So I should also say maybe that if you are away from where the gradient vanishes, then it's classical that a solution here is smooth. So what you really care about is at critical points for you, where the equation is degenerate. But so this result proved that it's even at critical points, the function is still twice differentiable. And at critical points, the Hessian actually has a very simple form. I'll talk a little bit more about that later. And so this classical degenerate equation, it was earlier showed that you could solve this equation in the viscosity sense some 25 years ago. And so this was one of the, I'll talk a little bit more about that also. But this was one of the celebrated uses of viscosity solution. But it turned out that the function is twice differentiable, and it turned out that actually solutions are classical solutions. You don't even need the viscosity sense because they actually solve the equation in a classical sense. And again, while the second derivative exists and we can show it's always bounded, in general, it's not continuous. Right? So this is a kind of optimal regularity proof that solutions are always twice differentiable. So optimal regularity is obviously a classical analytical problem. But in order to prove this optimal regularity, it rely on deeply understanding the underlying geometry. The ideas in the proof use a mix of geometry and also of real algebraic geometry. And so this is all joint work with Bill Minkoti. And so, so once one have this optimal regularity result, then further development on this equation that I'll describe, it connects with, so its part comes from the techniques involved in proving it. But it connects, so further development that I'll describe connects with Rene Thom's work on catastrophe theory and singularity theory. And we believe that these results, these further development, are the first instances of a general principle. And this general principle is that solutions of many degenerate equations behave as if they are analytic, even though they have much lower regularity. If this general principle is true, then it would actually explain various conjectural phenomena. Okay, so I believe that these, I believe if they turn out to be true, that this is a general principle, I believe this will have, it will have various applications to kind of well-known phenomena that really current techniques have no way of addressing, okay? And so, so let me come back to the equation. So I'll describe all of these things, but I want to come back to the basics first. So I want to come back to this elliptic degenerate equation. Where does it come from? So it comes from that you're looking at a hypersurface. The hypersurface will eventually be thought of as this moving front. But at the moment, I'm just looking at a fixed hypersurface. N is the unit normal of this hypersurface. H is the mean curvature scalar. So this is just the divergence of this unit vector field. Right? And so if you want to write it out, right? So the divergence is just the sum of the derivatives and then inner product with the corresponding EI, right? Where EI is this orthonormal basis for the tangent space of the hypersurface at a given point, right? So this is that this is the mean curvature at that given point. Now, so this is just this is what the mean curvature is. This is what the unit normal is. Now, suppose that the hypersurface is a level set of a function. So suppose that you have some function on Euclidean space, and suppose S is a regular value, and the hypersurface is a pre-image of S. Well, then obviously the unit normal is just a normalized gradient, and therefore the mean curvature is just given like this. Right? So the mean curvature flow is then a one parameter family of hypersurface where the point at a given time, the point is evolving by it's moving orthogonal to the hypersurface and the speed is minus the mean curvature, right? So if you have a one parameter family of hypersurface that is moving by this equation, then it's said to flow by the mean curvature flow. So this is a geometric heat equation. It was first studied by Birkhoff. The first reference I know of it, but there might have been earlier, is Birkhoff in 19-teens. Independently, it was studied in the material science literature already in the 1920s. If you were a physicist, you would think of the mean curvature as the surface tension, and the equation has this property that the area decreases the most efficiently. Okay. Now, so here's the simplest examples of mean curvature flow. If we're looking at it in R3, if we're looking at a one parameter family of round two spheres with radius, so here I'm thinking about time as being negative, and I'm looking at a one parameter family of round two sphere of radius square root of minus 4t, all centered at the origin. This one parameter family of two spheres flows by the mean curvature flow. If you're looking at cylinders, so round cylinders, where the radius, so this is again, I'm looking at R3, I could look at, or similarly, I could look in higher dimension. But if I'm looking at round cylinders where the cross section, so this is a circle, round circle, where this have radius square root of minus 2t, t is again negative, then you will see that these here actually flow by the mean curvature flow. And you observe that at time t equal to zero, the surfaces are not any more surfaces, right? The first one here have shrunk to a point, and the second family here has shrunk to a line, right? So this is correspond to that the evolution become extinct at that time. It right after that time, it disappeared. It became singular at that time, and right afterwards, it's gone. Okay, and here you see these examples, and the even more trivial one, but less interesting, is just the plane where the mean curvature is zero, so nothing happened, it's static under the flow. Right, but these the spheres and the cylinders and also the plane, right, they're self-similar under the flow. This means that the shape at a later time is exactly like at an earlier, except it's scaled. In this case, it's scaled down. So they're self-similar in this way. And so two very simple but key properties are, so one is that the mean curvature, and this is part of, you know, why the mean curvature flow is interesting. It's a gradient flow for area. So the under the mean curvature flow, the volume or area decreases the most efficiently. And the second basic property is what's called the avoidance principle, The avoidance principle is just a geometric formulation of the maximal principle. And so this say that if you have two initially disjoint surfaces, so these surfaces are just illustrated as if they were curved. So the red one is one surface, the blue one is another surface. If you have two surfaces, they are initially disjoint under the flow, they will remain disjoint. And again, this is just the maximal principle. And the idea is that if they didn't remain disjoint under the flow, then there would be some first time where the red one, the outer one, would have just caught up with the blue one, right? So since it was the first time, this would mean that the blue one would have to lie in, still would have to lie inside the red one, but would touch at just one point. But at that point, you see that the mean curvature of the red one is actually smaller than the mean curvature of the blue one, which means that the blue one is moving faster. So it means that if you go back a little bit in time, the blue one must have crossed the red one, right? So that's the avoidance principle. And this is really, you know, another way of thinking about it, right? This is just sort of a geometric term. It just, if you write down the equation, just boils down to the maximum principle. Right, in one dimension, the mean curvature flow is called the curve shortening flow. The simplest example is that of a round circle. So under the flow, it shrinks through round circle and in finite time become extinct in a point. And then there are a more interesting example that I'll show next, which is sometimes referred to as a snake. And so let's just see this. So this here example here, this first example here, it illustrates a theorem of Gauge and Hamilton from the early 80s. And so this theorem of Gauge and Hamilton say that if you take a convex curve, so the outer one here, you should think of as the initial curve. So if you take a convex curve in the plane and you run the curve shortening flow, the convex curve under the flow, so again, so the outer one, think about that as the initial curve. The first one inside the outer one, think about that at some slightly later time. And then all the other one you should think of as later and later times. And so the theorem of Gauge and Hamilton say that if you take a convex curve under the flow, it will remain convex. It will move inside itself. And it will eventually at some time become almost round. And then once it becomes almost round, it will keep shrinking and eventually disappear in a point. And that point, if you kind of rescale right before it disappear, it would look like almost perfectly round round circle. Okay, so this is a theorem of Gauge and Hamilton from, I believe, 84. And so now Grayson proved, it may have been 82 or something like that, Grayson proved in 89, he proved that if you take any, I should also have said that my surfaces, and in this case my curves, are always, my surfaces are always embedded. If it is a curve, then we usually, we don't talk about a curve is embedded, we usually say that it's simple. Right? And typically my surfaces are, and the same with curves, are closed. So there's a theorem of Grayson that say that if you take any simple closed curve in the plane, so this here is supposed to be a simple closed curve that is kind of wrapping around itself a number of times. If you take any simple closed curve in the plane and you run the curve shortening flow, so this here is the initial time, this is at a slightly later time, slightly later again, etc., down here. If you run the curve shortening flow, then actually in this case, if you take any simple closed curve, it will start unwinding. It would unwind, it's going to shrink. And the reason why it will shrink is comes from the avoidance principle. Because if you take any simple closed curve, you can just encircle it by a large round circle. You know that the round circle in finite time will become extinct. So, and whatever is inside it will remain inside it. So that will also disappear. So it's going to shrink. right, any simple closed curve is going to shrink, but the theorem of gradients say that it's actually unwinding faster than it's shrinking. And so this means that it's, that what happened is, so by the theorem of gradient, is that it will unwind and eventually at some time it will be quite small, but it will at that time it will be convex. And then the theorem of Gauge and Hamilton take over, and it say that once it become convex, then as time go by, it become rounder and rounder, and it will eventually disappear in a point. So this is the theorem of math gradient from 89. Any simple closed curve in the plane shrinks to a round point in finite time. Okay, so that's kind of the story. That's conclude the story for the curve shortening flow for the curve shortening flow. But in higher dimension, various interesting phenomena happen. So here's a very simple example of a surface of revolution. This is a torus of revolution. If you're looking at this as the initial surface, you run the flow, the mean curvature flow will preserve the symmetry, so it will remain a surface of revolution. And and it will shrink, the cross section here will shrink, and it will disappear in finite time, it will disappear in a circle. Okay. There's another example, more interesting example, of Matt Grayson, also from 89. And they say that if you take a dumbbell, so this is a dumbbell in R3, so it's rotational symmetric around an axis here. And in this case, the two bells here have equal size. There's also, actually in this particular example, there's also a reflection symmetry around here. So this example of Grayson say that if you take a dumbbell like this, connected with a thin bar here, this thin neck, then under the mean curvature flow, the neck here will pinch off first, cutting the surface into two pieces, and later each of these two bells will shrink to a round point. So this is illustrated. This is actually a computer simulation done by a guy called Uwe Meyer. And so, and he also did the, he was also so nice to do the computer simulation for the theorem of Matt Grayson earlier. So, right, so here again, so this is the initial time, this is a slightly later time, right? Here you see the neck have just pinched off, the surface becomes, it's a heat equation. So the surface actually becomes, it doesn't really look like it here, but it becomes instantaneously smooth after the neck have cut off, and it will evolve, keep evolving, and it will smoothen out here, and the two bells become actually convex and then eventually disappear in a point, each of them. And so this here, this example here, so Grayson had a kind of crude way using the avoidance principle to say that it will, that the neck will really break off first and break into, and the surface will break into two pieces. Slightly later, in 91, this example here sits inside a much larger family of examples of surfaces that are rotational symmetric. So all surfaces that are rotational symmetric around an axis like this was completely analyzed in around 91 by Altshuler, Ankonen, and Giger, and also they analyzed, you know, sort of the family in complete generality of surfaces that are rotational symmetric with some further assumption. Similar results was proven at the same time by Sona and Soganidis. So they analyze completely. If you have a surface, initial surface, that is rotational symmetric around an axis here, they understood completely what happened. And the basic method that they were able to apply, which is of course very particular to that example, but still very lovely, is a Sturm-Liouville comparison theorem. For that exists, but it really only exists for a one-dimensional heat equation. Okay, so there's no other version of that, and so and that was a theorem. This Sturm-Liouville comparison theorem was proven earlier. I mean, of course, there's a very classical one, but that's not for the heat equation. The one they're using is one for the heat equation. that was proved earlier by Ankenent. Okay, so that was the basic technique. And right, and so but you see also in this sort of picture here, it begs, or already here it begs to make sense of what it means to flow in the case where it breaks into pieces. There is a moment where the surface is not anymore smooth, and yet you are continuing the flow through that point. So one of the next slides are going to be talk about how to make sense of the flow past a singularity. And this was work of Chen, Giger, and Godo, and Evanson's book that I'll get to in just a second. Right. And so this is really what's called the level set method. The level set methods have been extremely successful numerically, and this was numerically it was brought into play by Osha and Session in 89, and they have a method for they're looking at these equations where you know you're tracking a moving front, again as I said in the beginning, the prime example of this is where the speed is the curvature, so the one we're looking at. And they developed something called the level set method. It was earlier considered, this idea was earlier considered, certainly in the material science literature was considered, but they, you know, they weren't able to do anything with it. But they in the material science literature, people already understood how to track, you know, that there's a reasonable notion of tracking a surface past a singularity. But they couldn't prove anything about it, but they just wrote down what is now known as the level set equation. Okay. So the basic idea here of Osha and Session is that you have this moving front and you want to track what happened to this front as it's moving with this curvature dependent speed. And so you choose a function. So you want to take the geometry away from the equation, right? So instead of looking at the surface as it evolved, you want to reduce it to a question about PD, about some function satisfying some differential equation, right? And so the idea is that you choose an initial function. You have this initial hypersurface. All our hypersurfaces are closed and embedded. You take a function that has this hypersurface as a level set, and let's say is positive in the, so you have this hypersurface here, and let's say that you take a function that is positive in inside, negative in on the outside, and let's say zero on the hypersurface. And now the idea is that you want to flow. You don't just flow this, the hypersurface that is given to you. You want to flow all the level sets. So not just the zero level set, but all of the level sets. And the simple idea is that if you flow all of them, then you get an equation, differential equation in the function, right? And so now the geometry is gone. It's a kind of, it seems like a simpler question where you're reducing it more classically to a PD question, okay? And so by the avoidance principle, right, if you're flowing, if you're taking two different level sets, well, we know that those level sets will remain disjoint under the flow, okay? So this leads to this degenerate parabolic equation. This has been tremendously successful numerically. I gave a talk about this at Berkeley maybe a year and a half ago. Since then, there have been more than 2,000 references to this paper of Osha and Session. So it's extremely used all over the place. But Osha and Session, they in their celebrated work, they were able to give a numerical scheme to that would track solutions to this equation. Not much later, a couple of years later, in work of Evanson's book, Chen, Giger, and Godo, they were able to provide the analytical foundation for this equation. And so they were able to prove that you had continuous solutions. The solutions, so it's a differential equation, it's a second order differential equation. And so they were able to to prove that actually you had solution in this weak sense, which is the viscosity sense, and that solutions were unique and that they agree with classical solutions. I should say, I always say this because of my somehow because of my childhood, I always feel obligated at this point to pause for a moment and say that there was so this notion of viscosity was in the early 80s, and it was developed by Crandall and Pierre-Louis Lyons. This result here, again, of Evans and Spoke, Cenk and Godot, was really one of the major success in the theory of this notion of weak solution. But there was an earlier version of viscosity solution that I'm sure everybody here know, but I still feel obligated to mention it, of Calabi from the 50s. And so the basic idea is exactly the same, but the two notions are a little bit different though. The basic idea is exactly the same. Crandall and Lyons was unaware of Calabi's work. Calabi had envisioned, actually, there's no doubt it's not long ago I reread Calabi's old paper, and there's no doubt that Calabi, as I'm sure everybody here knows, his immediate applications was a geometric application, but there's no doubt that he had envisioned that it would be useful in purely analytical problems like this. Okay, but it's different. It is different, though. It's a little bit different, although the basic idea is the same. So now let's look at where the initial hypersurface is mean convex. So in this case, Evans and Spoke, Cenk and Godot by work of Evans and Spoke, Cenk and Godot, and Brian White, the mean convexity here is preserved under the flow. The hypersurfaces will move inward, and it will keep moving inward because it's keep being mean convex. It will sweep out the entire domain that the initial hypersurface bounds. So you are at a picture that looks, let me just get back to this picture here. So if you imagine that this is, you have a similar picture, although you don't have this conclusion in here, but if this initial surface is mean convex, then it will move inward and it will keep moving inward into itself. It will sweep out the entire domain, right? But you won't have this conclusion here does not hold if it's just mean convex. In fact, all of the examples I looked at so far, this here is actually a mean convex example. And this here is also a mean convex example. Okay. If you do it properly, I mean, it's not all dumbbells that are mean convex, but you can, you know, if the neck is thin enough and you construct it right, it will be mean convex. Okay. So, okay, and so now this leads to what's called the arrival time. So the arrival time is, so this is just that, so if you take a general hypersurface and you use this method of Ocean Session, so this level set method, then you get then it leads to a function that's satisfying a degenerate parabolic equation. If the initial hypersurface then is mean convex, then this degenerate parabolic equation is actually equivalent to a degenerate elliptic equation. And that's the one I looked at, and I will focus my attention on that, on the elliptic one, though many of the results apply more generally, okay? But I'll focus my discussion on the elliptic equation. And so this is what's called the arrival time. So remember that that our initial surface here is supposed to be mean convex. So at a slightly later time, it will have moved inside itself. It will keep moving inward. And so this picture here, which is supposed to be mean convex, and please don't look at it too closely. This was actually produced by Sethian, but it doesn't look very mean convex up there. But anyway, just ignore that little error. Then this is, of course, the dumbbell, and it's like you just slice the dumbbell. And so what you see here are the hypersurface at different times. The arrival time is simply just that you take this domain that the initial hypersurface bound, and you're looking at some point in the domain, and you're looking at what time does the hypersurface come through that point. That's the arrival time, okay? And the arrival time satisfying this equation that I wrote initially. So I should speed up a little bit, see. And so in the case of for the round spheres, shrinking round spheres in R3, the arrival time would be this function, this quadratic polynomial. This corresponds to that this just normalized so that it arrived at the origin at time zero. Right? Similarly, for the cylinders, the arrival time function is this quadratic polynomial, again normalized so that they arrive at this singular line at time t equals to zero. And so you see two things here. You see that the singular points, so in this case here, the singular points, so the singular point is at the origin, but that is exactly where this quadratic polynomial has a critical point, right? And similarly, you see that in this case here, the singular for the flow, the singularities is just the line, right? But that's exactly the critical set of this quadratic polynomial. And so you can actually prove this more generally, that critical points for the function are exactly singularities for the flow, right? So if you want to think about it geometrically, you think about the singularities for the flow. If you want to think about it analytically, you think about the critical point for the function. And the second thing is this, but this is kind of, these examples are too difficult to fully appreciate this more general principle that somehow you should think about this function as part of a tail expansion of this. But you don't see any other terms, so it's maybe a little bit hard to appreciate this point, but this will be an important point later, okay? And so here's this equation. This is the arrival time equation. And this, I should also say that, so here we're looking at where the front is moving monotonically. Numerically, these have been numerically modeled even more efficiently. In this case here, been modeled more efficiently. In particular, there's something called the fast mouthing method of Thesian that is dealing with this case where the front keeps moving inside itself. Okay, and so this is the equation, and what you do is, so this is what Evans and Spruch did, and independently at the same time, Chen, Giga, and Goto, they rewrote this equation in this form here, right? And it's when you rewrite it in this form here, then it lends itself to talk about that you have solution in a viscosity sense. It really comes from rewriting it into this form here. Right? Okay, Tom Ilman in his thesis proved that, so published I guess a few years later, but he proved that there are solutions to this equation here that are not C2. So in general, solutions are not C2. And Tom's example really came actually from the exact dumbbell that we looked at earlier. It came from a particular dumbbell, like this, that has two bells of equal size. It had a reflection symmetry like this, and you're looking at the arrival time there. If he constructed it exactly right, you know, with the exact right symmetry, he was able to prove that the arrival time function is not C2, okay? And so, right, and so it turned out that theorem of Tom actually is, so Bill and I proved that, so remember that we proved earlier that this function is always twice differentiable, and at critical point, the Hessian is in a particular nice form, the second derivative is always bounded. But we also proved that, so this is this theorem here, and right? And so, but let me just go to this and come back to this thing from the previous slide, just because I kind of got a little bit ahead of myself, that there's also a converse to this. And they say that when the function is C2, so that you can completely characterize when the function is C2, right? So in general, the function is always twice differentiable, the second derivative is always bounded. But when the second derivative is actually continuous, you can completely characterize it. And so the second derivative is continuous if and only if the function has only one critical value, which corresponds to that the flow only becomes singular at one time. There's only one time where the flow is singular. And moreover, the critical set, or if you want to think it geometrically, the singular set for the flow is either a single point where the Hessian is exactly like the Hessian of the arrival time function in spherical case, or it's a simple closed curve just like it was in the case of the donut, the rotational symmetric donut. And in that case, the critical at this where the singular set was just this round circle, so you can prove that that the arrival time function is C2 if and only if you either have one of these two cases. There's a single point where a single critical, the critical set is, there's only one critical value, and there's only a single point where you have where that is critical for the function, or there's a simple closed C1 curve that is the critical set for that is exactly the critical set for this function, and in that case the Hessian is exactly like a cylinder. And in the second case here, the kernel of the Hessian is exactly tangent to this singular curve. Right, and so you see that these three, these two here are illustrated in these examples. If you take the sphere, then you will be in, then the arrival time function is, well, it was actually a quadratic polynomial, so it's certainly C2, and this exactly fall into the first category. The cylinder, of course, fall in exactly to this case here. The ring is also C2, and this falls exactly into this second category. The dumbbell, well, there are two different singular times, right? There's one time where the neck broke off, and then there's a second time where each of the two bells disappeared. So it doesn't, there's not just a single critical value, so it doesn't fall into any of these categories. So it's actually, it's not C2, right? But that's in the particular case where it had this reflection symmetry, this recover, of course, this theorem of Thom. But of course, this here has nothing to do with any, I mean, this is just in complete generality. We're not assuming any kind of symmetry here. I should also say that I'm stating the theorem as if it was in R3, but it actually holds in all dimension with, you know, with kind of trivial modification. So, but it's just for simplicity, I just stated it in R3. Okay, so again, we have talked about, you know, this singularity for the flow, right? It's when the hypersurfaces are not smooth, singular points for the flow. Analytically, you would think about them as critical points for the arrival time function. Here were these two examples. I'll just go a little bit faster because else I think I won't get to the end. and so now here is just very briefly, here's very briefly the key points in the proof. So right, if you want to prove that a function is twice differentiable, well, of course, you know, you want to prove that it's a quadratic polynomial up to higher order term. But right? If you want to prove that in a point the function is twice differentiable, then you want to prove that there's a kind of tail expansion, right? So there's a quadratic polynomial plus higher order term that approximate the function in a neighborhood of that point. Now, of course, again, as we talked about in the beginning, we're looking at this degenerate equation, but it's only degenerate at critical points, right? So away from critical point, by classical results, you know that solutions are smooth. So you only need to check this, that is twice differentiable at critical points, right? The second order approximation here, this quadratic polynomial, is going to be the arrival time. We want to prove that it's arrival time of the cylinders, right? So we have a great candidate for this approximation. So this suggests that the level sets, if you're looking at, you have this critical point where you want to prove that the function is trisubstantiable, so you want to approximate the function in a neighborhood of that point by this quadratic polynomial, which is this arrival time function for the shrinking cylinders, say, then it suggests that near that point, the level set of the original function looks like shrinking cylinders. And that is indeed true, and this was already known before. Now, what the key point, though, as you may recall, if you are trying to prove that even a function is just one time differentiable, right? To say that a function is differentiable means that it is up to a higher order term, a linear function on all small scales, on all sufficiently small scales. It looks like a linear function up to higher order terms on all small scales. And that linear function is the same on all scales, right? It doesn't do you any good if it looks like one linear function on one scale, then you go to a much smaller scale, it looks like a different linear function. And it's the same sort of thing here. That is the key to proving that a function is trisubstantiable, and this was really the difficult part here. So this here is illustrating, and this here was proven earlier by Bill and myself. And so this is supposed to illustrate that. So this is so in the middle of this, say, yellow cylinder right there inside it. Think about that as the critical point. And you want to prove you would like to prove that the function is trisubstantiable at that point. And so imagine that the level set of this function right before, at a time right before, the level set looks like, in a neighborhood, it looks like the yellow set. And look, but imagine also that at a slightly later time, the level set looks like the blue set. And at even later time, it looks like a red set. If this here was possible, then the function wouldn't be trisubstantiable. And so Bill and I proved earlier that this here is not possible, that it actually has, that these cylinders will have a limit as you're going down, right? Okay. And so this is uniqueness. And what made this really complicated, this case here, and required new techniques, is that these level sets here are, it basically comes from that the cylinders are non-compact. Okay. So right, so that's the key. The key to proving trisubstantiable is proving this this kind of uniqueness. Okay. Now, so now I want to get into. I want to get into some more recent stuff, some very recent stuff. And so, so after we know the optimal regularity of this equation, so we're not done actually, because we wonder. Initially, I woke up, a few years ago, Christmas morning, and I was just wondering, what if solutions. That was before we had proven all of this. What if solutions were always analytic? Okay, what can you conclude? And so actually, you can if it was analytic, you can actually solve a bunch of conjectures that are well known. Now, of course, now we know that the function is not even C2. Okay, but you still wonder. Okay, it's not analytic, maybe, but what if it's? But it's not. You know, you don't a priori need the function to be analytic. You just need it to have the property that analytic functions have, okay? And so this is where it connects with this work of Rene Thom. I guess Rene Thom was here many years ago, and his work in singularity theory and chaos theory, catastrophic theory, sorry. And so but the background is that if you take a analytic elliptic PDE, then solutions are analytic. Again, degenerate equation has much lower regularity, and solutions only exist in viscosity sense. Now, if we so So now we are interested, and again, we think that these are the first instances of this general principle, that for many degenerate equations, solutions, they won't be very regular, but they would behave as if they were even analytic. Okay, and so this is this is the first result, and then that we proved. Bill and I, we proved that in the case where the function, remember that if the function is C2, the function won't be C2 in general, but even when it's C2, it's in general not C3. It's, you know, it's like, it's like there's almost no functions where it's C3, even when it's C2. Okay? So, okay, which remind me, by the way, I skipped a slide and I forgot to come back to it. That was kind of relevant for this discussion. This was this here. I should have said that in a convex case, Whiskin proved in 1990 that the arrival time function is always C2. Bob Cohn and Silvia Safati proved in 2006 that in the plane, if you take a convex curve in the plane, then the arrival time function is C3. And Natasha Sesson proved in 2008 that if, so this is in a convex case, these are always sort of where the initial surface is convex, that in general, the arrival time function is not C3. In fact, her result is a little bit better. I mean, it proved that essentially it's even when it's C2, which it is in this case by Whiskins, it's for even when the initial surface is convex, there's if you perturb it in a kind of arbitrary direction, it's not going to be C3. Okay. So now coming back to this, and so I'm skipping this. I mean, the idea of this here is using, it's coming, some basic ideas coming here to prove this uniqueness comes from real algebraic geometry. The key point here was, though, it required entirely new ideas. and this comes from the non-compactness of the cylinders. Okay, and but the first thing Bill and I proved was, you know, to go a little bit further, that when the arrival time function is C2, well, then we proved a Voroshevitz inequality. So this here is a Voroshevitz inequality, and we conjecture that you have, even when the function is not C2, you have a similar Voroshevitz inequality. It's known that you can't get this power here. This power won't hold, but you only need, the Voroshevitz is only asking for a power greater than one. Okay, so so now we proved this. This was not too hard, actually. You know, once we have all the other stuff with uniqueness and all of the other stuff. So this here was not too hard. This was really not our goal here. But what we were interested in, further properties of analytical functions. Now, I should say, though, that the Voroshevitz, so this is a really basic inequality altogether, but it's certainly a very celebrated inequality in real algebraic geometry. And so, so a basic consequence of, once you have a function and you have that inequality, then you will immediately get what's now known as Voroshevitz theorem. And the Voroshevitz theorem say that if you have an analytic function, so Voroshevitz proved this inequality, not with this power here, but with a power greater than, strictly greater than one, with a constant C, both C and that power allowed to depend on the function. Okay, and so he proved this for all analytical function, and he used it to prove, he used this kind of, this is the Voroshevitz gradient inequality. There's another Voroshevitz, and they are actually closely connected. They are actually kind of equivalent. There's also another Voroshevitz inequality, and Voroshevitz used these. This is in the late 50s, early 60s. He used it first to prove a conjecture of Lorentz-Schwarz, which was called the Schwarz division conjecture, which was about distribution. If you have a distribution, can you divide it by an analytic function? So he used this inequality to settle that conjecture. Hermander at the same time also proved that conjecture, except Hermander couldn't actually quite prove the conjecture. He could only prove this kind of inequality for polynomials. And so that's why Hermander's name is not attached to this, because he only established independently at the same time, but only a special case of it. And and Borisiewicz went on, and he used it to a few years later. He used it to prove another kind of well-known conjecture at the time, also in real algebraic geometry, which was called witness conjecture, and it was about deformation retract of analytic sets. Okay, so this is a kind of famous inequality, and okay, and it leads immediately, and this is kind of the basic point in the in Borisiewicz's proof of the Whitney conjecture. It leads immediately, once you have an inequality like that, it leads immediately to this Borisiewicz theorem. And they say that for an analytic function, if you take a gradient flow line, and that gradient flow line, so you flow, the gradient flow line has a limit point, then it has a unique limit. In fact, what he proved is that this gradient flow line has finite length, and hence it has a unique limit, okay? So now, Rene Thom, just to come back to this place, and Rene Thom, yeah, sorry, yeah, 5 minutes, yeah. So Rene Thom was, so in the late 60s, early 70s, Rene Thom was interested in singularity theory and catastrophe theory, which is all about a gradient flow for analytic functions. Okay, and so Rene Thom was interested in a generalization of Borisiewicz's theorem. And so what Rene Thom conjectured was that that if you take a gradient flow line, so imagine that this here is a gradient flow line of an analytical function. So if you take a gradient flow line of an analytic function, well, by the Borisiewicz theorem, we know that if it has a limit point, it has a unique limit. So it kind of will go towards that limit. But Rene Thom went one step further and he said, why not? Why shouldn't the secant? So the secant is that you take this point here, you're looking at this point. As you're going in here, you're looking at the line segment that goes from the limit point to the point where you are. So this gives you a line segment. And Rene Thom was saying that if you renormalize that line segment to unit size, that's what's called the secant. And Rene Thom conjectured that the secant would have a limit. Okay, and so this means that this figure here, which is some sort of Archimedean or logarithmic spiral, would be impossible. This here is supposed to, the red line is supposed to illustrate the critical sets that the curve, it is a three-dimensional picture, and so you have this critical set and you have them spiral into that. Okay, so that was that was Rene Thom's gradient conjecture. The there was a lot of work on that. The Rene Thom's gradient conjecture was finally settled in 2000 in a paper by in a paper I don't actually remember. There was three Polish guys in a paper of Annals in 2000. Bill and I, but actually there's a stronger conjecture. So Rene Thom maybe here, but I guess that was too early. But somewhere in Paris, Rene Thom was talking about his idea about singularity theory and catastrophe theory. And Arnold was in the audience, and Arnold went one step further, and that one is still unknown for analytic function. And so the Arnold's conjecture, which is a refinement of Rene Thom's conjecture, say that the velocity, the unit velocity, as you're going towards this critical point on a gradient flow line, then the velocity of the unit velocity should converge. Okay, this immediately implies Rene Thom's gradient conjecture. That's unknown, that remain unknown for analytical function. But in this case of these degenerate functions, Bill and I can prove this, so we can prove both, I mean, both. I mean, even the stronger conjecture of Arnold. And so in the, and again, I want to emphasize that there are, that if this principle is true, that these solutions to these degenerate equation behave like analytical function, it will solve various conjectures, known conjectures for flow. I just mentioned one immediate one, but there's various other. That it is believed that a flow should only go through finitely many singular terms. And this would be, there's no, as far as I know, there's no way of approaching this, but this gives you a way of approaching this. So then in the last minute I have, I want to talk about other equations, okay? And so I want to talk about systems of equations. So a particular system is the Ricci flow. So there the metric is evolving by, so the, over time, the metric is evolving in the direction of the Ricci curvature like this. Shrinking cylinders are the singularity models. By result of, of these guys, just because I'm running out of time, I won't mention them, but they're there. In two and three dimensions, shrinking solitons are spheres and cylinders. In higher dimension, there are many more examples. It's expected that in all dimensions, the prevalent singularities are cylinders. Here, with prevalent, I mean in terms of dimension reduction. So these are supposed to be the typical singularities. The second most typical singularities are expected to be also cylinders like that. And so Bill and I can prove that for the Ricci flow, cylinders are isolated as shrinkers. And we believe we also can prove the corresponding uniqueness, that if you have a tangent flow that is a cylinder, then all other tangent flows are that cylinders as well. And so, this theorem here is related to an earlier result that we did with, and this is isolated in a very strong sense, which is a sense that is relevant for this problem. And it just say that if you have any other shrinkers that is close to one of these cylinders, it's a shrinker for the Ricci flow. If it's close to this a cylinder like this on a large but compact set, you only need to know a compact piece of it, then it must be that cylinder. So I'll stop here just because I'm out of time.
In the dumbbell example, how are you moving past the singularity? Are you doing surgery?
No. So I mean, that's where the level set method come in, right? Because the level set method, right? So it gives you this degenerate equation, right? A degenerate equation. So and the work of, so that's exactly what the work of Evans and Spruch and Chenkic and Godot is. That you can make sense of solutions even at critical points for this equation. So there are these, there are these different notions of going through singularities, right? The sort of class. I mean, there's at least three classical. There's one of the Georgi. There's one of Brake, using geometric method theory, the Georgi using regularization, and then there's the level set method.